new parts for World War II V2 rockets are pretty rare, one way and another. Parts for the guidance systems are even rarer. In the course of the last couple of years at the Wernher von Braun Rocket Academy, we've been trying to assemble components for the V2 guidance system so that we can understand it a little bit better, and we've actually done quite well. We've now got a range of components that would enable us to power up the gyro that we've been able to get hold of. An instinct in me led me to think that if I got hold of some wiring diagrams, I might be able to put these parts together myself. Good sense, however, has prevailed. And after speaking to our good friends at the Imperial War Museum, they've put us onto some experts at Kearsley Airways who are going to be able to help us, if we can get these parts going, to connect them up and maybe produce a wiring loom for us. We've got things like wiring diagrams to help us along. Without further ado, let me show you these components that we're going to try to actually restore to full functionality. One of the first components we've got here is an inverter system. This runs on 27 volt DC current and produces 40 volts multi-phase. It's actually three-phase, operating at 500 cycles. This is manufactured by the electrical producer Alfred Ohmig, often referred to by the engineers working on the V2 simply as an Ohmig. When this went wrong, they would talk about simply replacing an Ohmig. So that's this umformer, this transformer device. Basically, at one end, we've got a DC motor system, and at the other end, we've got a AC dynamo. This is the control system for that. This is a regulator, a frequency regulator. So these two components belong together. This is basically a gigantic version of the same thing. This is also by Alfred Ohmig. This is another one of these inverters, and this is also producing the 40 volts AC. This is the star attraction. This is the Vertikant gyro system. I'm going to show you this in a little bit more detail later on, when we actually get it going. But first up, we're going to take these components over to Kearsley Airways and see what they've got to say about it all. Martin.
Hello, nice to meet you.
Thanks for seeing us today.
No problem.
Martin Bowman was kind enough to give us a quick tour through the workshops while we were there. Kearsley Airways actually formed in 1947 and have been associated with Stansted Airport since that time. They describe themselves as an aircraft component overhaul specialist with particular emphasis on the C-130 platform. This is the big transport aircraft that's still being used globally. And brings an awful lot of work to Kearsley's. In fact, you can't really miss it. As you go round the workshop, one of the things that really strikes you is big lumps of the C-130, especially the undercarriage gear and that kind of thing, sitting around being worked on. As you go around the workshop, you see quite a few projects in various stages of completion, all being done with meticulous care. This really is the kind of place that I could spend a lot of time in. I think I could amuse myself here very nicely, just watching everything that's going on. But time now to get down to the serious business of looking at the V2 components that we've brought over. I'll show you what we've got squirreled away in here. We'll set the scene a little bit. So there's a transformer. There's a frequency regulator, and there's the Vertikant gyro. And we've got a couple of other little bits and pieces to show you there. A state of bafflement is setting in already. Okay, this is what V2 relics normally look like after they've been used. They end up, this is a guidance part, a prototype element from the tail of the missile. This is part of the fuel handling, propellant handling system, and you can see the state of it. The parts we've got here, you can see, I've never been flown, They've been recovered from warehouse storage facilities in the last 2 to 3 years. This is probably one of the first times that they've been in the same room together for nearly 70 years. They are the right components, so that's basically a big version of that transformer. We've got a very simple flow diagram which tells you what we want to talk about. That's the system. The bit we've got, or the bit that we're interested in, is this chain coming from the battery system, which is 27 volts, running through the alternator system, going to the Vertikant gyro. So that's the chain that we're interested in, just that little part there. And you can see we've also got the frequency regulation system.
Is that just a single gyro?
It is, yeah. So this is just the vertical component gyro. We've only got the one. Although it looks good, we know that one of the problems with the gyro was always the fly legs, you know, the pickups. Yeah. And you can see the pickups there over the years have been touched by people. Some of them appear to be working okay. First of all, what do you think about the stuff? Does it seem familiar in any way?
I mean, the inverter is similar. It's like a yeah. Type 100, isn't it? It's very yeah. similar. You could run that, I would imagine.
Yeah, it's fine.
Obviously, that's the same again. Does that just, I mean, that is just a more powerful system.
27 volts, we could power that up.
Yeah.
8 amps.
Yeah, it's fine.
So that bit straightforward.
It's straightforward. Obviously, if we've got an output from that.
Do you reckon that gives you enough to figure out where it goes and where it comes out? They haven't said, put it all in your bag and take it away. No, they haven't said that.
Yes,
so
this is this one. And then you can run your gyro.
Yeah. It's got to work out.
This is separate, isn't it?
Frequency regulator.
Yeah.
We've got a low standard of expectation because we're probably thinking that all of the units, primary units, are faulty. That's the way we're thinking about it. They look nice. I mean, when you look at them, they look to be in remarkably good condition when you consider their age. We want a wiring loom to connect all components together. So that's one of the things we're after. We're hoping you would be able to develop the wiring harness without having functionality. In other words, that you can do it from the principles rather than having functionality. Then we would deal with trying to gain what functionality we can from each component as a separate issue, if necessary. So you're happy now, you're undoing screws and things, aren't you? I can see you've warmed up entirely to the whole thing now that it's
quite intriguing, isn't it? It is, to see this sort of technology.
Well, what we're hoping to do, obviously, is hear them again and see them function. A lovely project would be at some point if we could get a meter on the potentiometer outputs from the gyro so that we can actually see it deflect, but probably secondary to actually getting it going. So though this is German and 70 year old, you think the technology of 70 years ago that we had in Britain is pretty much the same?
Some of the inverters we do, the older ones, are very much like this little Type 100.
I think I've seen one from a Hurricane. That looked,
Type 100.
You know, when I was looking to identify this, I think I found one from a Hurricane that looked very similar.
We do a lot of Hurricanes, but it's our ones.
Okay. So this is more familiar territory.
Yeah.
What about the gyro?
These are not quite so familiar. No. We don't play with gyros, to be honest with you.
No, okay. Very difficult. That's a very, very difficult component to get hold of. Very difficult. We're happy to leave you guys to do that voodoo that you do so well.
Once we get it running, we'll give you a call and you can come and take part two.
Brilliant. Chess, what you got for us? It's all squirreled away in the box again, is it? Right. I see some new cables that I haven't seen before.
Nice, so made a couple of looms up.
It's tiny.
This is the inverter.
Yep, so that's that one, presumably.
And that's the, yeah. That's it, that's the control.
Do you have any problems with it at all, or?
Not really, only just getting the phase in and the field, and that was all.
And this is working as it should?
Yes.
Okay.
It's
controllable, isn't it, by the screwdriver slot there?
Yeah.
What adjustments have to be made on this? What does
just slide.
Frequency.
All it does is bring a if you look inside later, it brings just a piece of metal across the transformer, which changes the inductance.
Okay. How would they have checked that, do you think? What would they have checked? Would they have checked the RPM of this, or...?
No, you could do it with checking the frequency.
So just putting a meter on it, basically, and looking at what it's
putting. Which is what we
do. Yeah, okay. Yeah. And so on this end, this would have gone to their batteries.
Yeah.
Do you think batteries would have got it going better than using a benchtop?
Yeah, no.
Because wouldn't they have had more lower-down wallop?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And then we plug in that straight onto the top of the gyro, I take it.
I suppose you want to see this working.
Yes, I think so. If it does.
Is that the one?
No, that's it. It's all at the top. Oh, yeah, it just slides off, doesn't it? You're right.
So you can stand that on there. Okay.
And it's that way around, I take it. Bingo.
Okay.
Okay. Stand back, light blue touch paper. Okay.
It's going to be quite noisy when that fires away,
okay?
Okay. Hopefully this will run.
And I won't get an electric shock. I would say it is. One is making the more noise here. This is the one that's whining. That is lovely. That is great. And obviously we're hoping if we can restore that. That started pretty evenly. Fantastic. Of course, as great as it is, we don't really know. I mean, if we had one of the engineers here, they might have said, what's it making all that racket for? Have that out of there, straight away. We don't really know if that's got a problem with it.
Well, we do, because the frequency is correct, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can adjust the frequency, and the frequency is correct. And the output's correct.
And it being a bit noisy, they'd have tolerated that.
All of those.
It's doing 10 powers and
output. Yeah. So, okay, so you guys reckon it sounds okay?
That's fine.
Harder for you to judge this one,
well, we don't know,
but then you can't hear this over that anyway. And you reckon if we restore this?
Yeah, it's just the one.
Yeah.
It's broken, that one.
Yeah.
But it just looks as if it's been caught in the
fence. Well, there you go. It works.
I'm amazed. That's a really super job. Brilliant. Absolutely great. Okay, so far so good. I think this really has exceeded our expectations pretty much at every level. We really had thought that some of these components, if not all of them, would probably be faulty, and that's how come they survived, by being thrown in the corner somewhere or sent back to the manufacturer. To find that they all worked almost immediately without any adjustment has really been quite an extraordinary revelation. Anyway, we still had a little bit of work to do, you remember, on the gyro, because the fly legs, as they're often called, that's the actual pickups, one or two of them had been damaged. On your screen now is an original drawing of the Vertikant gyro. We've marked in the corner, left and right, the location of these very delicate pickups. The V2 engineers used to call these fly legs, and you can see one of them highlighted here. We actually needed to do some quite careful manipulation of these very fragile pieces of metal to bring them into good contact with the pickup tracks and coils. Let's just slide down to the bottom right hand corner while we're looking at this diagram and look at the data panel there. You can see that the Entwerfen, or design date that we've circled here for this drawing, is November 1941. But clearly, look to the top, modifications and amendments are still being made in April 1944. The name of the manufacturing contractor is also clearly visible. Anschutz & Co. GmbH, although now part of an American-owned company, they still have offices in Kiel and are still active in gyro design and manufacture. Let's have this out of its case so that you'll be able to see what's going on. This is one of the fly legs that was badly damaged. You can see how fine it is, and not too surprisingly, it's called a fly leg. And we could see another set of on the edge of the cylinder at the side here. I don't know whether you can see that. I'm going to point that out with my pen. These needed a bit of restoring to just bringing into good contact with the rest of the potentiometer. To do this demonstration, I'm just going to talk you through what we're doing here. So I'm going to use the wiring assembly that we got from the guys at Kearsley Airways. That's connected up there. Now, the cabling for the gyro, I've added a couple of cables here so that we can connect it up to a meter, so that all the time we're running the gyro, you can actually see the readout from it that's being picked up now that we've restored the damaged fly legs. So let's just connect this up as well. Okay, that's ready to go. Instead of a battery, the V2 would have had a really quite substantial 27 volt battery system. Instead of that, we're using a mains power supply. It needs about 10 amps to get it going. Now obviously the battery system would be able to achieve that very easily because all of its oomph is kind of low down and it can deliver the amperage needed immediately. Our mains driven one is going to need a little bit of help to actually get this lot going. The meter's ready to go. That's going to show you anything interesting that happens when I go to move the gyro. So let's just get it going. Okay, there's our 27 volts. And we're on about 5 amps there at the moment. That's going to gradually improve as it comes up to full power. And that should drop down to about 3.5 amps when it's up to full RPM. This is being supplied with 500 hertz. That's probably getting the motor going, the rotor in the gyro, up at around about 20 to 24,000 RPM. Now that's gradually going to come down as the inverter warms up and the gyro gets up to full speed. I'm showing a bit of a tendency, I think, to shout because it's actually very, very loud for me, even though the microphone's probably just picking up my voice. I don't know whether you can hear it or not, but one of the chief sources of that scream is actually the frequency controller for the inverter. And it's this, it's the aluminium case on here that's making a lot of that racket. Difficult to know whether that was a common problem for the Germans, but presumably they just didn't really worry about it when they were getting these things ready to go. Keep your eye on the meter needle. And I'm just going to give the, just to show you there, nothing happening in that direction. Now we've only got the meter needle connected up to one set of pickups. Going to find the direction that we need to be in to make this go. Okay, there we go. The Vertikant would have been mounted literally vertically in the rocket, sitting on a platform. And you can see as I move it over, the needle deflects directly in relationship to my movement and restores itself to the same position there. Now obviously that a voltage would be being passed across the pickup. That would be going down to an amplifier system, which maybe through a mixer, and then down to the jet vanes and the air vanes to actually control. So as the rocket deviated from its path, the gyro would show that deviation on the meter. Then the jet vanes or the air trimmers would then bring the rocket back to its original position again. I'll show you that one more time. I'm actually going to cut the power to it now because that's probably going to give me a headache of some sort if we keep that going. So there you can see, in fact now that all these systems have gone down, that sound you can hear there now, I'll bring the microphone a bit closer to it. That's the gyro spinning down from that 20,000 RPM. That's actually going to be going for a few moments yet. So there you can see, that's a we've been very successful in this project, and we're going to be installing this in a slightly more elaborate system in our museum, and this will be something that can be seen for anyone who wants to come along and having a look. We've only got another 60,000 parts to go, and we'll be ready to build the complete missile. I'm reminded of Johnny Cash's song, "I got it one piece at a time." Anyway, that's it for now. See you again soon. Bye now.